welcome to you all to my talk about Apache Commons beyond string utils. We have already seen over the course of the day what's beyond string utils, because we had the talk by Rob about Commons text, and Dapeng soon has given a talk about crypto. But nevertheless, I'd like to show you what there is in Apache Commons that you might not already know. So this talk originally, I developed it originally for what we called Apache Roadshow. That was a tour throughout Germany, which I did with four of my colleagues, where we went to several Java user groups and presented our Apache projects. And everybody had a lightning talk where he could talk 10 minutes about his project and explain what the project is about. And since I believe people who go to a Java user group already know what Apache Commons is, I thought it might be a good idea to give it a different twist and talk about the stuff that maybe the usual Java developer does not know. So, and then I extended that talk, and this is what you're hearing now. So, who am I? My name is Benedikt Ritter. I'm from Germany. I work at an IT consulting company called CodeCentric. I'm a member of the Apache Commons PMC. Some of you may know me by my Apache ID, which is britter@apache.org. I do Java and Scala at work, and a little bit of front-end stuff. Can't get your way around that most of the time. yeah, and I've recently become a podcaster, so I'm hosting a German podcast about software craftsmanship and agility. So if you are in the podcasting sector, meet me after my talk and we can share experiences. And if you want to follow me or see what I'm doing, you can just follow me at Twitter or visit my GitHub profile. So, enough about me. Let's have a quick poll. Who has never heard of Apache Commons or has never used one of the Apache Commons components? That's good. So I don't have to explain what Apache Commons is, because there was the State of the Union talk in the morning about Apache Commons where I talked about that. So I can keep that short. And we'll dive right into the agenda for this talk. I'll give you a very brief introduction of the project, because although most of the people know it, there are some details about Commons that probably not everybody knows. And then I'll talk about selected components and show you some code examples of stuff you might not already know. And in the end, we have some time for question and answer if you like to ask something. So first question, who is this presentation for? Yeah, mostly JVM developers, because the Commons libraries, they are all Java, all written in Java. So you could easily use them in Java, of course. You can also use them in Scala or Clojure or any other JVM-based library, but you will get will have a hard time using them in Rust, for example. It wouldn't make sense. The talk is for beginners, intermediates, and pros. I think there's something in it for everybody, and maybe for potential contributors. So if you're using Commons components already and you are thinking about giving something back to the community, meet me after my talk and we can talk about that. Why is this talk important? This is what I call Ritter's law. It's my law. I've made it up myself. And I think everything that is not part of our domain or business logic, it has already been implemented by something much smarter than us. So every technical plumpering detail, it has already been implemented. Parsing CSV files, it has implemented. You don't have to implement your own CSV parser, for example. You don't have to implement your own networking protocol. That's not part, at least if you're an application developer, a business application developer as I am, that's not part of your job to build this stuff. It is already there. Our duty is to solve business problems and focus on that. So there's also in extended Ritter's Law, which I learned after I got into IT consulting, and that is everything that's not part of your core domain or business logic, or the crazy legacy system you happen to need to integrate, it has already been implemented. Because, you know, sometimes there are these crazy systems that you have to talk to, and usually there's no library to talk to that system, and that is a case where I would say, okay, you have to implement this technical plumpering. But other than that, my take on that is you should focus on business functionality and not on input-output or codec or compressing stuff. There are libraries for that. And Apache Commons is a project that maintains a set of useful libraries. So let's talk about the Apache Commons project. Where does it come from? I've talked about that in length this morning, but I'll give you a short recap of that. There originally was the Jakarta project at Apache, which was an umbrella project for all the Java-based projects back in the early 2000s, or I think 1999 was the inception year of the Jakarta project. Apache looked much different than today, so they don't had that much Java project. I think when you look at the language statistics today, most of the projects, or a good bunch of the projects, are Java or at least JVM based. But back in the days, there simply haven't been any Java projects, so they thought, okay, what is Java? Let's just make a project and put it all into that. And that was Jakarta, and we had projects like Tomcat and Maven and Ant and Struts. They all were Jakarta sub-projects. And inside Jakarta, they needed a place to share code among these projects. For example, Ant and Maven, they both needed algorithms for compressing stuff. So they created Commons Compress to put the algorithms to creating tarballs or zip files. And what the ASF realized is that umbrella projects, they don't work very well, because an umbrella project, you have a group of communities that are pretty isolated from each other, because you had the Jakarta Tomcat community and the Jakarta Maven community, and then the question arises, okay, why do we need this umbrella at all? Just why isn't Tomcat just Apache Tomcat? And that was the time when Jakarta was split up into several top-level projects, and so Jakarta Commons became Apache Commons, and is the successor of Jakarta Commons. So what is Apache Commons' mission? This is my mission statement. It's not the official mission statement that's on our website or something. That's my view on things, what I think, what we should do. And we should provide a place for other ASF projects to come together, to collaborate, and to share common code. So if any of you are already committers in some project and you think you have some useful code that could be useful for other ASF projects, just talk to us, come to our mailing list, and we'll see if it fits into Commons. A quick overview over Commons. Most of you probably have heard these terms already. At Commons, we have an area we call proper. These are the mature components like lang and I/O and math and net and codec, all the stuff you already know. So if you take one of these, they are usually pretty battle-tested, and you can rely on them. Then we have the sandbox, which is a playground for trying out new stuff. Whenever somebody thinks, hey, this might be a good idea, I just code it up, they can create a sandbox repository and just do it. I think the sandbox comes from a time where we didn't have stuff like GitHub, where you could easily share your code, and people needed some infrastructure to host code and share it with other people. So today, usually when somebody wants to try something out, he just creates a GitHub repository. But we still have this sandbox, and yeah. And there is Dorment, which is kind of the attic of Commons. So at the ASF, we have the attic project. And whenever a top-level project isn't any useful anymore, or there's nobody interested in maintaining it anymore, it is moved to the attic. And we have kind of the same thing at commons, which we call dormant, and we move components that nobody needs anymore to dormant, and then there's nobody working on them anymore, there are no more releases, and yeah, that's it. That's the end of the life cycle of a commons component. So it's time to have a look at code. That's probably why you're all here. So I'm going through commons lang, and probably everybody of you has already used commons lang. So I'm starting with a very simple example. And this is the well-known string utils is empty method, which you can ask if a string reference is null or empty. So what you see in the first line, the string equals null or string is empty, you can combine that and just call string utils is empty, which is a good thing because you get rid of some of the duplication you have in the first line, because you know the problem with duplication. It's almost in every place it looks alike, but then you have the place where somebody doesn't call string is empty, but calls string.length equals zero, and the next one compares to an empty string, and you just don't want this diversity in your code base, so you just use the is empty method. But let me give you a craftsmanship advice or a design advice. I think if you have an overuse of this is not empty, is not blank, string related methods, that may be a sign of a code smell inside your code base, because it seems that you're encoding a lot of information inside of strings on the one hand, so you're working a lot with strings, so that might be a problem because you're not building higher level concepts instead of using strings. And the other problem might be that you're having an anemic domain model. So you probably have a lot of beans with getters and setters. And because these beans, they can't check their own state, you always have to check, is this property really set or not? So think about a customer which has a customer ID, which is a string for whatever reason. And because there's a getter and a setter for the ID, every time you get the ID, you have to check, have to make sure that it's really set. So that's bad practice, I'd say. It would be better if a customer only makes sense if it has an ID, to create a constructor, pass that ID to that constructor, make sure it is always set, so that you can be sure when you get an instance of customer that there is always an ID. So just an advice. That's sometimes when I look at code bases that overuse these methods, that's a sign of these code smells. Okay, but let's get beyond string utils. And as you can see, there are a lot of utils in commons lang already. So for nearly, for a number of the well-known Java classes, there are accompanying util classes. We have a utils class for arrays, for example, which is pretty cool because it has methods like add an element, because in Java, you know, arrays are fixed size. So if the array is full and you need to append another element, you have to allocate a new array which has the size plus one and copy all the stuff from the old array to the new array and put the new element at the end. You can do that with one method call when you're using array utils. There are several other utils, for example, date format and date utils, which I'd say you shouldn't use anymore because we have the Java 8 time API, which is much, much better. But still, if you need to use date because you are talking to some legacy API or have another library that needs dates, then you can have a look at date utils, and it hopefully will make your life easier. We have string escape utils. Rob already talked about that. It has been since moved to commons text, so we are in the progress of splitting commons lang into several more focused libraries, and Commons Text is the first one of these libraries, which is related to text processing algorithms. And WordUtils has already been moved? I think yes. No? But we are about to move it to Commons Text.
1.1.
Yeah, okay. So let's have a look at one of the utils maybe not everybody knows, that is SystemUtils. And SystemUtils provides very easy access to the Java system properties. So you all know, when you run a Java program, there is the runtime, which is represented by the system class, and you can ask it for properties and can introspect the environment you're running in. You can ask it, what operating system am I running on and what architecture am I running on. The question is, why would you do that if you are writing Java? Because the idea of Java is that you don't need to know that. But anyway, you can ask your runtime which operating system you're running on, and you always have to do a lookup by a string key. So get property, for example, I think os.name, and it will return you the name of the operating system. But in SystemUtils, we have some constants that make it easier for you. For example, if you want to know, am I running on Windows 10, then there's just a Boolean constant. So you don't have to do this lookup and get the string right everywhere. Just use the constant. Another example is the Java home, which is the folder of the Java installation. You can look it up by system get property java.home, but you can also use our constant for that, which does exactly the thing. But I like to have constants in my code. I don't like to have string keys that are passed into the get properties method, so I like this more. Another example is the get Java home method, which returns a file, because if you're asking where's my Java home, give me a string, you probably want to access that directory or that location, so it would make sense to have a file object. So that's why we have the constant and the method. Another cool thing is the which Java version am I running on. That's often useful when you are writing libraries which have to support several Java versions. And you can ask SystemUtils if you're running at least on the given Java version. For example, here I've added an example where I'm asking it, am I running at least on Java 7? So can I use the features introduced or the classes introduced in Java 7? And why do I need it? This is an example I took from the integration test library of, or the integration test project of the Maven Surefire plugin. Maven Surefire is the plugin that runs tests in Maven, and they have an integration test project. And because I'm working on the JUnit 5 support in Maven Surefire, I need to make sure that a test is running on Java 8, because JUnit 5 requires Java 8, but Maven Surefire, I think it's built on Java 7, Java 6, I don't know exactly. Anyway, I can only run those integration tests if the tests are run on Java 8. And this is an example where the is Java version at least method came in handy for me. So maybe you are writing an internal library and you also need to support several Java versions, you could use this one, this method for checking it. Okay. Then we have builders for the common methods defined in object. I think this is another example of an API that a lot of people probably know, because it gives you a helper for implementing equals, for example. You know, when you implement equals in Java, you have this kind of preamble that you have to add in front to make it more efficient, let's say it like that, where you say, okay, if the object you are giving me is null, then I know it can't be equal to me because I'm not null. If the thing you're giving me is myself, then it's equal. And the next one is, if the thing you're giving me has a different class, it can't be me. Interesting detail, I'm checking that get class unequal this get class instead of checking instance of. Any idea what might be the difference between that? Yeah, you. Yes, right. That's exactly the case. The question is, can classes that are inheriting from my class be equal to me? Because I cannot check their properties. So if the subset of the properties that I inherit to them are equal, I would consider subclasses equal if I put an instance of check there. And the question is that really equal or not? So I usually do it like this because I say, okay, if they don't have the exact same set of properties, they can't be equal to me. But sometimes that's also something you might consider for your application, for your domain model, whatever. And then we come to the stuff I wanted to talk about, the common slang classes, and that is the equals builder, which you can pass values and it will compare them for you. And you don't have to make sure that, for example, if this name is null, but that name is not null, if you implement it by hand, you have to do all sorts of if-else control flow to make sure that if both is null, it's equal. If one is not null, it's not equal, and stuff like that. This will is all already implemented in the equals builder. And there are builders for hash code and compare to as well. So you could use that if you like. Then we have the str substitutor, which Rob has already talked about. We have moved it to Commons text, but it's interesting nevertheless, and it's still part of Commons, although it's not no longer part of Commons Lang. And you can think about it as a template engine in one class. So you probably all know Maven properties, which you can resolve in your POM file by putting their name into a dollar and curly braces notation. And the string substitutor does exactly that. And here in this example, I'm substituting system properties again. I'm using the Java version system property and the os.name system property. And when I call this replace system properties method and pass it a template, it will replace these properties for me. But I can also add custom substitutions. And here I'm creating a map, a singleton map with just one key value pair. The key is custom key, the value is some value. And then I create a new string substitutor with these values to replace. And then I can say str substitutor replace and pass it my template, and it will replace custom key with some value. And the second one, that is the syntax for adding fallbacks. I think it's the same way as in Bash. Any Unix pros here? In Bash, you can also use this double colon, colon minus syntax if you want to define fallback values. What I'm seeing right now is that this slide has an error. There are the dollar signs missing. Oh, okay. Okay, yeah. But that is configurable in string substitutor. So if you want to have other markers, then you can configure that if you want. And we have so much more in Commons Lang other than string utils, because I always get the feeling people know string utils and that's pretty much all they use from Commons Lang. So why do you pull in this library if you only need this one class? You can just copy it or whatever. But we have mutable variants of the primitive wrapper types. So you know, when you create an integer object in Java that is immutable, you can't change it anymore, maybe you need a mutable variant of that. So we have the mutable integer. So you could ask, why would I need that? that comes in handy, for example, if you have anonymous implementations and you want to pass values between the outer scope and the inner scope, because when you want to use something inside an anonymous code block, all reference to the outside have to be final. So if you want to pass an integer out of that, how do you do it? What people often do, or what I have seen often, is use an atomic integer, because it's kind of the same. It's a wrapper type for an int value, which you can set and get. But that feels strange, because an atomic integer that has something to do with concurrency, and I wouldn't expect that if there is nothing about concurrency going on. So I find it more more clean, or I find it cleaner to use, for example, a mutable integer. We have mutable and immutable pairs and triples. So if you know Scala, for example, then you probably have worked with tuples a lot. Think of it as two values that you don't want to give a name. For example, a point in a coordinate system, you could express that as a pair, if you like. We have contexted runtime exception and contexted exception, which is pretty cool, because oftentimes when you have code that needs to access some API which throws checked exceptions, for example, the file API, the IO API from Java, you always have to catch this IO exception. And now you're down there, 10 levels deeper, working with the file and getting this IO exception, and you don't know what to do with it. So what do? You log error, something bad happened. Return null. So because the problem is, at that point in the code, there's nothing you can do, because you don't know from where you have been called. And the code way up your application, for example, the controller that initiated this whole processing, he knows how to signal this error, for example, by returning 400, 500, I don't know, or showing something to the user. But the controller doesn't have those details that are down below. So you can use a contexted runtime exception and pass context values of the failure you just happened to see. For example, the file wasn't there, or the file was not readable, or the file system was not available, or whatever. And you can use that exception and pass it up the whole stack. So instead of catching that IO exception and logging an error and returning null, it's probably better to catch that exception and then throw a contexted runtime exception up the stack. The good thing about that is, when your method, which is accessing the IO API, returns, you know that it has worked, because otherwise there would this runtime exception been thrown. That's good style, I think. And we have the text translation and escaping, which has already been moved to Commons Text, but it originated in Commons Lang. Okay, I need to hurry up a little bit. Commons Lang and Java 8 and 9, what about that? We have Commons 3.4, which requires Java 6, and we are working on 3.5, which will require Java 7. And we have discussed, what about Java 8? Should we switch to Java 8? But we think that is a topic for Commons Lang 4.0. Sorry? 3.5 now. We're working on 3.6. Ah, OK. Yeah, sorry. Then just add one. So Java 8 is not a topic for Commons Lang at the moment. And about Java 9, the code builds and runs on Java 9, because we are not doing any magic stuff which is permitted in Java 9. OK, let's have a look at another component. This is Commons CSV, which I have worked a lot on and which I like a lot, because I think all of you have already implemented their own CSV parser, right? Everybody has. And usually you hear something like this: we don't need a library for this, it's so simple, we just have to do a split at the comma, and then we're done, right? at first it sounds that easy, but the problem is that CSV files, they are standardized in RTF 4180, but there are a lot of variants. So unlike XML, which is pretty strictly specified, CSV, the standard just says, okay, we have a delimiter character for our entries, and we have a record separator, that's it. And then comes Microsoft and says, okay, we have Excel, it's different, we have a semicolon. And then comes MySQL and says, our export format is this and that. And this variance, they differ in so many aspects. So you have different delimiters, you have different line break characters, you have quoting, for example, when you have you define a quote character and say, okay, when I quote something by double quotation marks, for example, then please ignore all the delimiters you will see until the next quoting character. We have escaping, so if I have a quote and I have a backslash before that quote, then that is not quoting, that is just something that is escaped. Some formats have a header record and others have not. And all of a sudden, a simple split becomes a real nightmare. And another problem by our simple split by the comma solution is that it's terribly slow because it's using regular expressions under the hood, and you don't want to pass a 1 gigabyte file using regular expressions. So what we do with CSV, we have an extended buffered reader, and we go through the stream and do it character by character, and looking ahead and looking back, and that's the trick behind that. It's pretty fast. We have already predefined some of the well-known formats like Excel and MySQL and TDF, which uses tabs to delimit entries. And this is what it looks like. So you just create a new file reader, pass it to the appropriate format, and then you can iterate over the records. And important thing is that we don't read the whole file into memory and give you an iterable of the records, but we just read as far as you have iterated. So whenever you get the next record, we start reading the next record, which is, again, a good thing if you think about how big this files can be. And we hand you a record, and you can ask the record for the header name, for example. If you have a column with a header last name, you can say, okay, give me the value of the last name column, and it will give you the string. Of course, you can customize the formats. So you probably have that one system that sends you an export, and it's, of course, not like all the other CSV formats. So here's your API to define your own CSV format. You can just derive it from one of the predefined formats using a Fluent Builder API. You can ignore empty lines, for example. You can set the header. There's also the possibility of detecting the header. If you just call with header without any arguments, it will use the first line and use that as header. It's because a lot of formats, they have the header inside that file, so it makes sense to just use that first line. And what I really like is to define the header using an enumeration, and because, again, I don't like strings in my code. So I'd rather define an enum and have that to access my record values. As you can see, it looks pretty much like the example we had before, but instead of getting values by name, we pass an enum value and use that. So internally, it uses the toString method of the enum. So, yeah. So in conclusion, tasks which may seem simple in the beginning can be more complex than we think. Remember, don't reinvent the wheel, even for simple things like CSV parsing. Remember my law, your our duty is to implement business, solve business problems. And Apache Commons CSV is easy, it's customizable, and it's really, really fast. But it has some limitations. For example, printing does not support all the features we currently support for parsing. So you cannot only read CSV, but you can also print CSV with CSV library. But we don't support crazy line break characters, for example. So if your line break character is an exclamation mark, for example, that won't work. We don't have type conversions, so you always get a string because CSV is a text-based format. If you want to convert that into something else, you have to use that string and do the parsing in, for example, a number or a date. You have to do it yourself. And on top of that, we don't support mapping into Java objects. So all we give you is this record, this low-level representation of that file, and whatever you do with that, it's your job. We have been asked to create some sort of CSV to Java bean mapping, but up until now we have decided that we think it's not part of this library. So if anybody wants to create such a library, go ahead. It's Apache license. Have fun. Okay. Last component I'd like to show, which probably not everybody knows, is the command line interface library, Apache Commons CLI. And the motivation for that, or why I think it's useful, is this. What I want is a nice, I'm writing a command line tool, for example, like Maven, and I want a nice help system, and I want help with parsing the arguments, and I want to have it all formatted, but what Java gives me is this. So, as you know, the main method is called by the runtime, and when you have compiled your program, and it gets all the strings that are behind your program, basically, in a string array, and then you can start. Implementing your help system and your command line argument parsing. And that's pretty tedious, because imagine what you have to do if you want to build up the command line RP that Maven has just on the basis of a string array. That's pretty hard. So we have Commons CLI for this, and Commons CLI is used inside of Maven to implement the command line option parsing. And what you do is you just describe which options your program has. So for example here, I've added a help option, which has a short name of h. So if I do minus h, that will print the help. And I have a long option, which I can call with minus minus help. And that will display the help is the short description, but I can also create more complex options. The second line shows you how to create a log file option, which has an argument, and the argument's name is file, and it also has a description which says use given file for log. Okay, so we have two options, h help or h. And L for log file. And then we pass the command line, the arguments array we get from the runtime. We put it into the parser and say, OK, parse it. And we get an object describing the command line. And this command line, I can ask it, do you have a help option set? Has the user specified help as an option? And if that's the case, I have a help formatter, which is also part of Commons CLI. And I can say, OK, print me the help for this program. And otherwise, I can ask it, do you have a file option? Should be a log file option, sorry. And then I can get that value out of the command line. And what it looks like, I have coded it up. You can look it up in my GitHub repository. It looks like that. Remember the code example I had two slides before? We had the age and help option, and we had display the help as description, and we had the L and log file option, which had an argument called file. You see that in the third line, and use the given file for log as description, and that's pretty neat, I think. Ah, okay. Yeah. So, final words. And I'm a little bit ahead of time, but that's okay. Final words. These were just a handful of the more than 40 components we have at Apache Commons. And there's so much more which could be useful for you. So take the time, look through the list, and check out the stuff we have there. There's, for example, Commons Codec if you need to encode stuff using different algorithms. We have Commons Crypto that Dapeng has already talked about. So if you need cryptographic algorithms and you need them really, really fast, you can have a look at that. We have Commons Imaging, which is a library for image manipulation. We have Commons Pool, which is below the Commons Database Connection Pool, a object pooling library. We have RDF, if you are in the semantic web sphere and work with the resource description framework, you can have a look at that. We have Commons RNG, which is the random number generator library, and we have a lot more components. And it's all online, commonsapache.org. Have a look and have fun. And with that, I think this is the end of the first day of ApacheCon. So if there are any questions, then just ask. Okay. No questions?
You mentioned that mapping CSV to an object was not part of your mandate, I guess. Could you elaborate on what is the reason for that?
Okay. The question was, what is the reason that CSV doesn't implement a mapping directly to objects? I think the reason is, there are several reasons. First of all, nobody had the time to do it yet. And we try to create very focused and kind of low-level libraries. And we believe that that CSV is about parsing files, text files. So if you parse a text file, you get a text and not a Java customer, whatever object. So I think, yeah, that's probably the main reason. We don't feel that it belongs into that component. But as I said, there would be no problem to implement it on top. Okay, no more questions. So, okay, I wish you all a nice night. Have a beer, meet me at the bar, and yeah, see you tomorrow or later.